This is 60 tips, all things legal from A to Z in 60 minutes. And I generally start with sort of general tips, but primarily child find, moving then into evaluation, then to eligibility, then to placement issues and IEP development, and then on to things that are sort of miscellaneous in nature, such as discipline, extended school years in here, least restrictive environment, and I also felt it necessary to include some tips on 504. Because 504 is in some circles outrunning IDEA in terms of its prevalence out there, especially in the last couple of years, and there's a lot of confusion about Section 504, so maybe those tips will help just a little bit. At the very end, just kind of for giggles, I have what I might call behavioral or attitudinal tips in terms of just thinking about how we can make our lives a little bit easier, whether you're a parent or an educator or one of each, which happens a lot. Hopefully those will help. So those will give us a sort of downhill slide at the end with those behavioral and attitudinal tips, not necessarily legal. All right, with that, let's get started. On page one of your materials, and hopefully you all have a handout. I think Jolly said that you should. I don't know if you accessed it via the jump drive or if you actually have a copy, but either way, I'm going to be following along in the handout. If you don't happen to have it in front of you, it won't really matter. I don't do PowerPoint often, but I certainly will for this, just to keep us on track. I hope I don't breeze through and forget about my PowerPoint. All right, so let's start with our child find and identification tips, first of all, and these are very general, the first couple, in terms of making sure, and I'm big into training, train all school personnel to take whatever we might call this, but I generically call it the problem solving team, child study team, student assistance team, whatever it might be called, it's something different everywhere I go, but that problem solving team process, take it seriously and train folks to understand that the role of these teams is not to get the child in special education. I hear that all too often. Usually it's with the rolling of the eyes. It's like, oh, that's all that stuff we have to do before we can refer a child. We need to train people to understand what that's all about. And there are legal reasons why we do it. Not just because your state might require it, not just because nationally it is the trend in terms of making sure that we focus on the provision of good scientific research-based strategies and interventions in general education. So we are doing that for everybody, and most states have set up some form of tiered process. That's what we're talking about, the problem-solving team process. But there are other legal reasons why states and school districts are doing these things. To prevent disproportionality and overrepresentation based on race or ethnicity. That's a big, big issue from the federal government's perspective. Preventing over-identification in special education generally. Those numbers are monitored by the federal government. And to ensure that students are provided with appropriate instruction prior to being considered at all for special ed. But it is not the way to special education. We need to train people to understand it's the way not to get there in the first place. Okay? And a lot of folks don't really understand that, and we need to make sure to train. The second training tip, train all school personnel, and certainly not to be legal experts in this. And I do it 100% of my time on a daily basis, but I don't feel sometimes like I'm an expert. But training people generally on all of the laws that apply to the area of educating students with disabilities. And I've named certainly the federal laws, the common federal laws that we deal with, IDEA. I do have to remind teachers from time to time that IDEA does not stand for I Do Enough Already. It is the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, ADA, Americans with Disabilities Act, and its sister statute, Section 504, the Rehabilitation Act of 1973. We have FERPA, implications, the Family Educational Right to Privacy Act, the No Child Left Behind Act, which will probably be at some point reauthorized, and they'll go back to the name ESEA, Elementary and Secondary Education Act. They're already abandoning that NCLB reference. And finally, of course, if you're in Indiana, your Indiana state rules, regulations, and laws. Just a little bit of training so that everyone is familiar with all of these overriding legal requirements, all of these laws as it relates to educating kids with disabilities. Number three, moving into child find, which is what the law uses as the terminology, child find and identification. Ensure that when developing and implementing an overall RTI approach. Now, I use RTI generically like Xerox or Kleenex. It's something different in every state where I present or actually do work, but I'm using it generically. But everyone, I think, in this day and time understands that RTI stands for Response to Intervention, Response to Instruction. But when putting that kind of approach in place, we need to ensure that in terms of child find and identification, a parent request for an evaluation is not met with the following statement: "Oh, I'm so sorry, but we can't do an evaluation right now because your child hasn't completed the RTI process." Very, very dangerous. In fact, when RTI started sweeping the nation, I was very concerned as a lawyer who has represented school districts now for almost 30 years in this area. I was concerned about the potential headbutting that would occur between RTI and child find. And so much so, not only was I concerned, the U.S. Department of Ed was concerned. And in 2011, they issued this memo to state directors of special education and anyone else who will read it. This was a memo that was issued in 2011. And it was interesting because a lot of people were concerned that this was a statement from the U.S. DOE that they were no longer in support of RTI. But what they said was, while we wholeheartedly support RTI, what we're concerned about is parents coming to us and telling us that when they go out and ask for an evaluation, what they are hearing from the school folks is, "We're so sorry, we can't evaluate right now. Your child hasn't finished RTI or hasn't started RTI." And they said that is not, from a legal perspective, a legitimate reason to deny an evaluation. Because child find under the IDEA is triggered by reason to suspect or reason to believe that a child is a child with a disability in need of special education services. So that's number four. Stress the importance and affirmative nature of IDEA's child find requirements. When doing any kind of what we used to call pre-referral, which, we don't call that sort of a done deal. That's why we've abandoned that language. But all of our pre-referral type activities, before we conduct evaluations, we must stress to everyone that this is an affirmative duty. Child find is an affirmative duty. It's not in response to anything. We are to look out for. We are required as schools to locate, evaluate, and identify as part of child find, notwithstanding what a parent might bring to our attention or what have you. It's an affirmative duty to conduct child find activities. So again, as I say in my materials, the child find duty under IDEA is triggered based upon reason to suspect or reason to believe. There are a couple of cases that I've listed there in my materials. Obviously, I don't have the time to talk about the cases per se, but we've had a couple of fairly recent cases really dealing with this issue. Child find in and of itself has become a huge issue. I would say that half of the cases that come into my office in the last couple of years have been child find cases where the parent is alleging that the school had sufficient reason to know or reason to believe that the child was a child with a disability in need of special education services, but the child, quote, languished in the RTI child study team process for several years before ever being evaluated. And the claims are for compensatory education. I'll tell you, I heard from a a lawyer who represents a lot of families in this area, one of my cohorts in Alabama. She told me that she believes that RTI is a conspiracy. And I'm thinking kind of to myself, conspiracy? That takes a lot of time to get together and conspire. We don't have that kind of time. At least the educators I work with generally don't have the time to conspire. But it's being viewed in some circles as a strategy to not refer children and not to exercise that affirmative duty. So that is a very important training tip in making sure that everyone is aware of that affirmative duty, even in a child find, even in an RTI world. The child find obligation is alive and well. Let's talk about number 5 and 6 maybe together. Watch out for referral red flags. This is what I call, this is my terminology, referral red flags, because many people ask me, okay, I hear you, Julie, about that affirmative duty based on reason to suspect or reason to know that a child is a child with a disability, but what does it take? What are those, quote, referral red flags? What would give an educator reason to suspect or reason to know that a child is a child with a disability in need of special services? Now, I have a list there on page 3 and over to page 4 of what I call referral red flags. And understand that this is the Q&D, quick and dirty version, of course, in this fast-paced session that we've got this morning. But I could talk about this for about 2 hours. In terms of all of the support in courts, case law, all of that kind of thing that supports this list that I've created. But I do want to make it really clear that that important note is extremely important, because I don't want anybody running back and saying, well, Julie Weatherly says every child on medication needs to be referred for an evaluation. That's not what I'm saying. It takes a number of these referral red flags to trigger the child find duty under the IDEA, but when you see several of them together, especially in a variety of the categories that I have set out here, perhaps that triggers the child find duty. There's no exact science to this, but these are things you need to train folks to look out for, especially regular ed personnel. All of our counselors, all of our regular education teachers, all school administrators should be very familiar with these referral red flags, because once there are a sufficient number of them, that could trigger the legal IDEA child find duty. I will also mention that the Office for Civil Rights looks for these referral red flags in the context of 504 as well. So they apply under 504 and IDEA, and as I mentioned in my materials, it's likely that the 504 duty to evaluate may be triggered before the IDEA duty to evaluate, and that is because the definition of disability under 504 is much, much broader than it is under the IDEA. So you can see there, I have actually sorted out the referral red flags into categories. So we have academic concerns that might trigger the child find duty, failing and noticeably declining grades. Now, I say noticeably declining because many times people will say to me, why should we refer her? She's not failing. It is not a wait to fail model. Okay, noticeably declining could be enough in and of itself. Poor or noticeably declining progress on standardized assessments. Courts use the terminology stands out. So negatively stands out academically from his or her same age peers. The student's been in our problem solving or RTI process, and progress monitoring data indicate there's been little academic progress. So our data can inform us as to child find and the need to conduct an evaluation. Or the student, for IDEA purposes, is already on a 504 plan, but the accommodations have led to very little academic benefit. Then we have our behavioral concerns. Of course, disciplinary incidents, very important, but some of the things that are overlooked are things that are not violations of the student code of conduct because the child is not actively, outwardly, a behavioral issue, such as a child who is depressed or withdrawn or inattentive. The next one is one of my favorites because I get this a lot from school administrators. She's not a behavior problem. She's never here. Truancy is recognized by courts clearly as a behavioral issue. It's expected that educators will take action with respect to that, not just filing truancy actions, but creating behavioral intervention plans and things such as that. Or the student, of course, negatively stands out based on behaviors. Some of those same things that are in the academic category. Then we have many, many times outside information that's provided to the school, either to the school counselor or someone at the school. Sometimes that's by parents. They bring things in. We need to consider that in light of everything else going on and look to see, are there other referral red flags that would bring some suspicion to our minds that this child might be a child with a disability in need of special services. So information, the child's been hospitalized in the past. We get a lot of this kind of information when parents enroll their children and they fill out. Now, I'm not saying that every child who's ever been hospitalized we need to absolutely evaluate. Just saying it's one referral red flag, so I'll remind you of that. Information that the child has received some DSM-5 diagnosis, whatever that might be, ADHD, ODD, OCD, anything that ends in D. Perhaps we need to take look. Student who is taking medication, another, again, just one referral red flag. Okay, there need to be others. One is not enough, so I want to make that clear. I'm very sensitive about that because sometimes my materials are taken out of context. Information the child is seeing an outside counselor, a therapist, or physician. I've had situations where a child's checking out of school 3 times a week at noon to go see a private therapist and having struggles and no one's thought to think maybe we should evaluate this child. Private evaluator, therapist, etc. actually recommends special education services or a 504 plan or a need for an evaluation. It's not determinative, but it could be one referral red flag alongside other referral red flags. And then information within the school itself. Many times a teacher might say, why haven't we referred this child yet? It's so obvious to me. And I worry in those circumstances. I actually had a case where teachers were emailing each other. When is this child going to be evaluated? It's so obvious to all of us. And sure enough, really the data indicated that it was obvious, especially when school personnel are saying that. Now, not because a teacher just finds a child needs too much from him or her. That's not going to be enough. But if there are legitimate concerns expressed among school personnel. And last but not least, parent request for an evaluation. I have some sample cases in your materials, just some FYI child find type cases. And I'm spending a little bit more time on this one because it's a big issue right now. Looking out for, making sure everyone understands it's an affirmative duty. All right, let's look at number 6. Refrain from diagnosing medical conditions or suggesting medication without the credentials for doing so. So that DSM that I was talking about earlier, you know, it just kills me when a teacher says, I think it's clear he has ADHD. Well, okay, where are your credentials there? We don't diagnose medical conditions, right? I'm going to talk about the opposite in a second in terms of private evaluators diagnosing educational conditions. But we are not supposed to basically be suggesting meds or diagnosing medical conditions when speaking with parents. And I think that's pretty obvious, but you'd be surprised how many court cases that we have on that. One that's pretty famous on page 6, WB versus Matula. The regular ed teacher actually told the parent, I think it's very clear that your child has ADD. He probably needs medication. I know that because one of my children does. But don't wait for the school district to conduct an evaluation because it will take too long. That conversation was construed by the court to constitute a referral for an evaluation that started a timeline. So we need to be very, very careful with respect to that issue. All right, let's talk about evaluations and reevaluation tips. Exercise the right to contract or conduct independent evaluations, particularly in cases where we might see some adversity adversarial situations, demands that the school necessarily doesn't see. Parent brings in a private evaluation. Maybe we're seeing that this might be adversarial. School districts should remember that the case law is very clear that schools not only have the duty to conduct appropriate evaluations, but they have the right to conduct evaluations by experts of the school district's choosing. And there have been a number of cases that have come out with respect to that issue. And so when clients call me and they say, we're not really sure, the parents brought in a number of evaluations, making some recommendations we don't necessarily see in terms of the need for those, I generally like to ask, have you asked to conduct an evaluation? Because again, courts, when looking at a parental demand, if the school district has requested an evaluation and the parent has refused, courts generally will bar any relief to the parent because the school district has made a legitimate request for an evaluation. So we have a couple of those kinds of cases. The GJ case on page 7, I just want to mention real quickly, this was a request for a reevaluation conducted by the school district. And the parent signed consent for it, but then wrote all over the consent form saying, but I don't agree with this, I don't agree with that, I want it done under all of these conditions, et cetera, et cetera. The court basically said that that was not consent, that school districts clearly have the right to conduct their own evaluations under the conditions that school districts use and by their own chosen professionals. All right, number 8, share fully all evaluative, relevant information and other educational information about the child with the parents. This is all part of parent participation. You're going to see a number of tips that deal with this one in terms of making sure that when we are sitting around a table reviewing all evaluative data, we share everything with parents. They are to be equal partners in decision making. How can they be equal if they do not access all of the same evaluative and other educational information that the school team accesses? The Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, now you're in the Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals, but we all listen to all of the circuits, frankly, particularly in the area of special education law. I've had a lot of associates as years have gone by, and they start practicing with me and I'll say you need to go research X, Y, and Z, and they restrict their research to our jurisdiction. And while certainly that's the place to start, if our jurisdiction doesn't say something, then we need to reach out, especially in special ed law. Courts and hearing officers generally don't feel comfortable making decisions about the education of students with disabilities. They feel better even if you can find a hearing officer decision from another state that enunciates a proposition. We tend to rely on that. So the Ninth Circuit authority there is important and basically found a denial of free appropriate public education, notwithstanding what program was offered to the student, merely because the school folks failed to share all relevant evaluative information with the parents. And that in and of itself, the court concluded, constituted a denial of free appropriate public education. All right, let's look at number 9. Refrain from suggesting to parents that they are responsible for obtaining educationally relevant information and evaluations, including medical evaluations for diagnostic and evaluative purposes. I hear that all too often. We're dealing with a child, the school team has met, they've asked the parent to go off and get the physician's report or some sort of medical information, and usually the parent says okay. But then months go by and we haven't gotten that information, and I'm interviewing school people that, well, we asked the parent 2 months ago to bring it, they just haven't. If the school believes that the information is relevant and necessary to making an educational determination, then the responsibility to conduct the evaluation is the school's responsibility. And we always need to remember that. In the MB case, in your materials, and I love the name of this elementary school, Hellgate Elementary. It's like I can hear the kids every morning, Mom, I don't want to go to Hellgate today, you know. But I wonder where that is. And I was in Montana last year, got on a little puddle jumper plane to go somewhere, and like 3 young ladies got on my plane, and they had Hellgate Elementary on their t-shirts. So this is a elementary school in Montana, apparently. But in this particular case, the school principal, in response to the parents' comment that they had gotten a diagnosis of autism in the past for their child, and that they were concerned that that needed to be revisited, the principal said, well, that's great. There's a clinic in town that'd be happy to do the evaluation. Let us know when it's done. Here's their card. And delegated, according to this court, that was delegation of the school's responsibility to conduct a comprehensive evaluation. Even though it was considered a medical evaluation, if the team says we need it, it becomes educationally relevant and therefore fits under the definition of related services. We do medical evaluations for diagnostic and evaluative purposes. Let's talk about our next one. Conduct comprehensive evaluations and evaluate in all suspected areas of need, not just disability. Yesterday, and I apologize to the group that was with me yesterday afternoon because some of these are a little repetitive, but it never hurts to hear it again, in terms of making sure that we keep the eye in IEP and look at the individual needs of children. And that's what comprehensive evaluations are all about under IDEA. But all too often, I find that sometimes evaluations get streamlined into a narrow view because we're going the SLD path or the speech-only path, perhaps, and we have overlooked behavioral concerns or whatever that might be. So the courts are very clear and the law is very clear itself. The regulations say that we must evaluate not only in areas of suspected disability, but also all areas of suspected need. Number 11. Make appropriate and thorough decisions regarding the need to conduct evaluations and presume, particularly as it relates to reevaluations, presume that we should do a reevaluation rather than presume that we will not. Now, I've been around a really, really long time, and I remember the days when reevaluations were absolutely required every 3 years. Do you all remember that? Where we had to redo the testing that we did in the first place to find a student eligible. We had to redo it, and almost it was sort of the concept was we need to confirm eligibility every 3 years. The law was changed, though, in 1997 on reevaluation, so the definition of a reevaluation is a little bit different. While it is required that we conduct reevaluation every 3 years still, reevaluation can be as simple as a team sitting down and deciding whether we need reassessment data. The notion was that too many children were being reevaluated or reassessed every 3 years, and many times they didn't need to be. For instance, pulling a deaf student out of class for a day of assessment was silly. And so that's why the law was changed. Leave it to a team to decide whether a student needs to be reassessed. But what I have found in my practice is that it's gotten too easy in some cases for a team to sort of, it's almost like the leading question. Does anybody here see the need to reassess? No. And we check no. And that really concerns me, especially when the child is not making the progress that we would like. And so that's why I say, especially in those cases where a child is not doing well and not making expected progress on those annual goals, we should be monitoring, clearly monitoring that, and always be asking whether we have a need to reevaluate. There have been numerous court cases that have faulted the school district for making changes to a child's program or not making changes to a child's program when they're not doing well, but not doing a reevaluation. So that can constitute a denial of FAPE in and of itself. Number 12. Consider the results of independent educational evaluations that parents bring to the table. Now, there's a long list of cases that support this proposition. I would say probably the DeBuo case is the most significant. It is considered a procedural violation that denies parent input if a school team does not, quote, consider private evaluations, and other relevant information that parents may bring to the table. Okay? So we must consider private evaluation reports, not necessarily be bound by them, though. I had a case one time, had to attend an IEP meeting, and I'll just tell you, this lawyer doesn't like to go to IEP meetings. I don't think attorneys have any business there. So I was in an IEP meeting one time, school psychologist took the private evaluation the parents brought in, and he tore it in half. And he said, I never read anything this quack writes. And I said, does anybody have any tape? So we can tape this back together and consider this evaluation report. The law requires consideration, not adopting the recommendations. And sometimes it may be that you have to bite your lip not to just break out into laughter with some of the private reports that I've seen in the past. But we don't do that. I see all kinds of things. Sometimes the private evaluator doesn't have time. Maybe it's a physician who doesn't have time to actually write a report. They just put their recommendations on the prescription pad. And they just tear it off, hand it to the parent, prescribes Ritalin, prescribes an IEP, one-to-one aid, special educate, whatever it is, the list goes on. 504 plan, one of my favorites. Told the group yesterday, I have a friend who is dealing with a case where the neurologist prescribed a 504 plan. Not 504 plan, but 504. So, but we're going to consider it, aren't we? We're going to consider that. Well, would it be a 5 plan or a 4 plan? Let's discuss that anyway. But we do consider. We don't just say, no thanks, we're not going to. And also, too, I like to train folks who might get this. Maybe the parent doesn't bring it to a team meeting, but hands it to a counselor, or it gets faxed over the school's machine and someone just puts it in a file. Someone should always be directed to bring it to the attention of the child's case manager or somebody at the school so we can decide whether we need to convene a meeting to consider that. Number 13, remember that parents have the right to request an IEE. This is formally known as an IEE, Independent Educational Evaluation. Now, sometimes I will hear from a client and they'll say the parents requested an IEE, and I have to determine whether they really have requested an IEE. This is a procedural safeguard that is triggered when parents disagree with the evaluation that the school district has conducted. And the school district, in response, has two choices. Either pay for an independent educational evaluation, that's assuming that the school district has conducted an evaluation, the parent disagrees with it. That's what triggers this procedural safeguard. But if it is a legitimate request for an IEE, the school district either pays or, without unnecessary delay, must request a due process hearing to defend its own evaluation. What do you think schools most often do? More often than not, they're going to fund an independent educational evaluation. And, you know, IEEs, school districts, my next tip, maintaining a district list of independent examiners in your region, and always update that list, update criteria for evaluators. That's always good to have. You know, when the parent asks for an evaluation, many times they'll also ask, can I see your list and criteria? But I will also remind you that, though, some of you who maintain the list and criteria, which all of you should, it should be up to date, and you should make sure to revisit that. Yesterday I was on a conference call with a superintendent and a special ed director, and they said to me, well, this parent is asking for an evaluation, an OT evaluation, by a group that's not on our list. And we have the three groups on our list. I said, I don't know where you got the idea that you restrict it to three. This is a new group that's developed close enough to you to include them on your list, or to seek information from them to see if you should include them on your list. So we can't necessarily tell a parent you can't go outside of our list, especially if there are other either evaluators or evaluation groups that are eligible to be on that list or should be considered. So that's a really, really important point to make sure. We're seeing, at least in my world, seeing a lot of requests for independent educational evaluations. Districts, again, two choices. Either pay for it or request a due process hearing to show that the school district's evaluation is appropriate. Number 15, comply with applicable evaluation timelines and document compliance. Of course, there are evaluation timelines. I do see the day to completion of an initial evaluation from the date of consent is different among states. So hopefully you're very familiar with what that timeline looks like. And there is usually a timeline relative to completing the evaluation to eligibility determination. The federal law refers to that as a, quote, reasonable period of time, but states sometimes define that. And then usually it's 30 days from eligibility to develop an IEP. My experience is most school districts collapse it in terms of not waiting that 30 days to develop an IEP once we've determined eligibility. But those timelines are very, very important. I had a parent attorney tell me one time that he can pretty much always find timeline problems with evaluations. That was a parent attorney who said it was kind of like sometimes shooting fish in a barrel. I think we've gotten better nationally, though, in meeting those timeline requirements. All right, let's move from evaluation and reevaluation to eligibility tips. So now we've done the evaluation. These tips apply to the whole eligibility process, and I better speed things up. This slow-talking Southern girl has a hard time with this 60 minutes. Okay, so provide the parent and their invitees an opportunity to fully and meaningfully participate in the eligibility process. I have this one in here. Some of you might go, oh, I know that. But I remember the days when the law did not require schools to invite parents to eligibility meetings. I've been around a long time. It was very odd because the parents would show up and it was a, guess what? We've determined that your child is eligible for special education. Now we want to develop an IEP with you. So the law was changed in 1997 to require that parents be an absolute member of any eligibility team, be provided that opportunity to participate. In determining eligibility, remember that the actual label doesn't matter. Purely as a proposition of law, it's eligibility for services and the need for services and provision of FAPE that matters. You'll see a number of cases there where the issue boiled down to a dispute over the actual label. The parent wasn't happy with the label that was chosen and wanted autism as the label or dyslexia as the label or something such as that. But the courts generally will say label does not, because it doesn't drive placement, right? That label legally is not relevant. It's whether or not the school district is meeting the individual educational needs of the child, notwithstanding the label. Do not limit the definition when determining eligibility. Oh, goodness. Do not limit the definition of educational performance to academic performance. When I'm looking at eligibility, at least in my view, there are three things that teams generally are going to look at. First of all, determine whether there is a condition present, such as IND or SLD, OHI, ASD, whatever that might be, those educational conditions. Number two, that adversely affects educational performance. And number three, to the degree the child needs special education. This tip relates to prong two of the eligibility determination, and that's whether the condition adversely affects educational performance. But courts have said we don't limit educational performance to just academics. And I do hear that a lot. Well, she's making good grades. Yeah. But how is she doing socially, emotionally, behaviorally? How's she doing with communication? Those kinds of things. Social, emotional, behavioral, communication. Those are viewed as educational performance as well, not just academics. So there are a number of cases that I've listed there for you. Probably the most famous is the Mr. I case there on page 12. All right, let's look at number 19. Remember the third prong. Okay, I went through the three prongs, but remember the third one. And a lot of litigation in the past couple of years with respect to this prong, where everybody agrees the child has a condition that does adversely affect educational performance, but the child does not need special education services. And when you look at the definition of special education services under the law, it says specially designed instruction so that a child can access the general curriculum and meet educational standards. If a child is doing that, then where is the need for special education if they don't receive special education? So there's been a lot of focus on eligibility, but primarily this TIP in the court cases in recent years. You'll see a couple of 2014 and 13 cases there. This is a big issue. The last due process hearing I handled, unfortunately, went on for 19 days, but it was all about whether this young lady who was diagnosed with Asperger's, which of course is no longer technically recognized under the DSM number 5, but at least in my world, those children are still being diagnosed with ASD. I haven't seen much of a difference there in terms of the level 1, probably in need of level 1 support. So I haven't really seen a change there, but this young lady didn't have any real academic concerns to speak of. In fact, she was performing well above all of her peers. A sixth grader performing on standardized assessments at over a grade 12 level. Had a few social issues and things like that, but could easily be addressed through social skills training and counseling, which are considered in that district merely as related services. Those are not necessarily special education services unless a state makes them by themselves. Special education. So this third prong is very, very important in terms of the need for special ed services. Number 20, distinguish between and making eligibility determinations, SED and what I might call BAD. But be careful. This is tough. This is very, very tough. I would never go to trial on one of these eligibility determinations probably without an expert witness on this issue, because judges are going to have a hard time understanding the difference between that, quote, socially maladjusted child and the emotionally disabled child. It's really tough sometimes. There are some experts out there, though, that have created scales and things that teams might use to help with that distinction, but it's pretty tough. One of my favorite cases of all time, just because of what the court said on page 15, the Brendan K case, talking about a situation, child with ADHD, teenager with ADHD, whose parent wanted the child found eligible as ED. And the court basically said, teenagers can be a wild and unruly bunch. Adolescence is almost by definition of time of social maladjustment for many people. I told the group yesterday, this judge must have been a parent of a teenager. That's all I can figure. Number 21, don't rely on medical diagnoses or recommendations for determining eligibility. Just because the doctor says so does not make it so. But as I said earlier, we do need to consider those opinions, and we need to consider whether we should do our own evaluations if we see considerable referral red flags. But just because the doctor says it doesn't make it so. The Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals, and you're in the Seventh Circuit, has a really good case talking about physicians' role in diagnosing conditions under the IDEA. There's actually a quote toward the bottom of page 16 that notes a physician cannot simply prescribe special education services. Many times we see, again, the prescription for the 5 or 4 plan, and the physician may really have no concept of what they just prescribed. I had a principal one time who said, well, I just tell the parents generally to take that prescription to the CVS and see if they can get it filled. All right, let's move to IEP development tips, okay? So now we've gone through child find, evaluation, eligibility. Now we're sitting down to develop the IEP. Number 22, refrain from action that appears to reflect what the law calls predetermination of placement. I talked at length about this with my group yesterday in terms of this taking the I and parent input out of the IEP process. That in and of itself can constitute a denial of free appropriate public education if parents are not provided with adequate opportunity to participate in the decision-making process. It is the fatal procedural sin in the IEP development process. Recent case on page 18, the RL case, I'll just point out, was a situation involving the LEA representative, the school leader at the IEP meeting, who basically set out the school's position that the child would go to the senior high school, very large environment the parents were worried about, and followed by the statement, "That's what we've decided. If you don't like it, you can take us to mediation." And the court felt like that individual at the meeting cut off the parents, would not consider anything that they were requesting. Based solely on that, the court said that was a denial of free appropriate public education. That's the most recent case. There are a couple of others there in your materials as well. But we have to be very, very careful about things such as, that's, you know, our way or the highway, this is the way we always do it, we don't have that here. All of those kinds of things could be considered a form of predetermination. That could be a day-long workshop also, in terms of predetermination. 23, don't predetermine, but do prepare adequately for IEP meetings. Nothing worse than people showing up unprepared at an IEP meeting. This is a big issue of mine. I'm actually going to talk about it in my breakout session in avoiding conflict. Good preparation is one way to do that. So I mentioned that here. Number 24, be sure to act reasonably in response to a parent request to reschedule. A legitimate request to reschedule an IEP meeting. I can't tell you how many cases involve this rescheduling issue. But of significance and got a lot of attention is this Doug C. case, where the parent actually called the day before the IEP meeting that was scheduled and said, "I have some medical concerns. I can't make it to the IEP meeting. I need for you to reschedule for later in the week." Uh-oh, the problem was the IEP meeting date was also the annual review date, or when the IEP would expire. You know what I'm talking about. So they were very concerned they couldn't reschedule because, uh-oh, that's the annual review date. They were going to get, you know, dinged by the state if they did not have that meeting. But instead of really explaining that to the dad, they went forward with the meeting. And their defense was, well, we had to because we would be in violation of the law and the State Department would come monitor us and find us out of compliance versus being out of compliance by holding the meeting without the parent. Court said, we understand your choices were tough. You didn't have, you know, good choices there, but you made the wrong one. It's better to be dinged by the State Department than to go forward without the parent at an IEP meeting. So that one sort of made waves across the country with State Departments taking a look at that. Let's look at number 25. Make IEP recommendations based on the individual needs, okay? Need I say more? This is the I in IEP. I spent 3 hours with a group yesterday talking about that. If you're interested, you can get a handout if you weren't able to attend, but that is a very significant issue, and so many courts have ruled against school districts merely because they were not at the table to consider the individual needs. They considered other things in making recommendations. Use a proper process for determining the least restrictive environment. LRE, 2 hours in and of itself, at least, to talk about all the case law relative to determining least restrictive environment. Courts and federal agencies have come up with standards generally for making LRE determinations. They're highly, highly individualized. You cannot make blanket statements about least restrictive environment. That probably, in terms of my practice, is the most individualized consideration, particularly when it is an issue. The next, in terms of IEPs, oops, sorry, I already had it up there. Avoid being overly specific and including unnecessary details or promises in IEPs. We certainly do a lot of training, don't we, of people in terms of how to complete an IEP document, what goes in this space, how to, you know, what goes, you know, in this line or box, whatever it might be. But we don't want to forget to also train what doesn't need to be on an IEP. Don't add. Usually, whatever the form is, whatever that methodology a school district may use as its IEP, whether it's a computer program or whatever it might be, generally that has all the components that the law requires. I call this one kind of the IEP teams gone wild that write all kinds of extra stuff, like methodologies or specific methodologies or something such as that. The clean case I put in there because I do see sometimes a lot of IEPing the child onto the football team, for instance. Participation in non-academic extracurricular activities. Had a case one time where the parent basically browbeat the IEP team into, you know, IEPing the child into the quarterback position. Well, no, that's not what we do. Those are not FAPE issues. And somebody needs to explain that your child, just like any other, clearly has the equal opportunity to try out for and be judged under same criteria as everyone else. But we don't write those kinds of things in IEPs. We don't write Barbara will be the teacher into the IEP either. Once you do that, you've made the personnel choices a placement issue. If you write Barbara in the IEP, better hope nothing happens to Babs. That's all I can say, because she became a placement issue. Number 28, address appropriately and annually the issue of ESY. This one's near and dear to my heart because I do a lot of work in Florida, and right now there is a statewide complaint against all districts in the state of Florida because the advocacy organization in Florida cold called people at every district to say, what does your ESY look like? Oh yes, we have it. It starts on June 16th and it runs through July 20th for everybody. Or yes, we have home packets for all of our SLD kids. Or yes, we, you know, it's very cookie cutter, blanket policy. We have to remember this is an annual determination for every child on an individual basis. So everyone should be trained on ESY in every district, trained to understand the policies and procedures of that district. I was at an IEP meeting years and years ago, very uncomfortable meeting. I thought we had gotten finished with it. I was really excited about it. And the parent attorney looked to everybody at the table and said, we're finished now, let's talk about extended school year. And before I could catch the eye of the special ed teacher, he said, what's that? And I did a little regression recoupment workshop out in the hall, and he came back in. He was great, and he said, I do not think she will suffer severe regression. He regurgitated everything I'd said, but we had no data to support that. Ensure the proper attendance of required school staff at IEP meetings. This is a big one. There's the membership right there in your materials. I guess for the most part, I get a lot of questions about regular ed teachers, so we definitely need to train them. And next of all, I get a lot of questions on who is appropriate to serve as the LEA representative. That's member number 4. All I can say there is let's make sure that those people understand, whoever's appointed to serve as the LEA rep, that LEA does not stand for least experienced administrator. Number 30, allow parents to bring invitees. This is part of parent participation. They have the right to bring people with knowledge or special expertise, and the USDOE has said the parents determine whether the people they bring have knowledge or special expertise. Remember that beginning not later than the IEP in effect when the child turns 16, where to address transition. Transition is up and coming. It is a big, big deal. Congress is looking constantly to outcomes for students with disabilities, and transition is very, very important. So we don't want to forget transition and to invite the student to the IEP meeting. The Gibson case, they did not do so, and the court felt like that was a denial of FAPE in and of itself. 32, address behavioral strategies. Clearly, this one generally, I'll read through an IEP, there are a lot of behavioral issues, and then I see this special factor. Does this child have behaviors that impede the learning of self or others? No. Like, oh, wait a minute, there's something wrong here. I did a 4-hour workshop just recently on conducting functional behavioral assessments and behavior intervention plans. It's essential, especially these days. Include appropriate statements of present levels of performance and make sure that there's adequate baseline data. That's for us school attorneys so that we can show meaningful educational benefit and progress. In the same vein, include appropriate measurable goals. That is a huge one. From a substance perspective, when the IEP content is being attacked, the measurability of goals is typically the attack. The measurability and the fact that they're not linked to present levels of performance. Then we have IEP implementation tips. Remember to inform all service providers of their obligations. This is vital in terms of implementation. Engage in continuous progress monitoring. We don't stop progress monitoring just because a child is eligible for special ed, but I have had that happen. I had a call one time with a special ed director said to me, when we make her eligible, she's in RTI and getting very intensive interventions and a lot of continuous progress monitoring, but when we make her eligible for special ed, she's going to get less. I said, I'm sorry, there's something wrong with my phone. I didn't hear you correctly. What is up with that? So I am seeing that a little bit, and that worries me. Convene an IEP meeting. If there's any doubt about the services the child is receiving or the child's benefit or ability to benefit from those services, absolutely. Procedural safeguards and tips, these are very important. Providing parents with copies of their rights, obviously we do that. Give prior written notice with regard to any proposal or refusal to take action regarding the identification evaluation placement. That is a fundamental procedural safeguard that is oftentimes overlooked according to parent attorneys that I work with. They say that they very often get a file that has no prior written notice in it at all. Number 43. Forget this. I'm not doing the PowerPoint. This is why I'm PowerPointless. Okay, you're following along. I hear you moving the pages. Avoid making unilateral changes of placement through the use of suspension or other removal for disciplinary reasons. If I were doing a day-long discipline workshop, that's my focus always. If it constitutes a change of placement using suspension or expulsion, there's a problem if we haven't followed an appropriate process. It's all about change of placement. Develop alternatives to suspension that don't constitute change of placement, including in-school suspension and things like that. So that's something to talk about as well. Number 45, be careful when considering whether transportation is a related service. I have a letter to Sarzynski there. Take a look at that. Suspension from the bus is very important as it relates to discipline and whether a change of placement has occurred. Number 46, look out for those regular ed students who might assert the protections of IDEA. Those referral red flags coming around again in terms of regular ed students. Number 47, using the 45-day special circumstances removal provisions appropriately. I actually train a lot of school administrators on discipline rules, and many times there's a lot of confusion on those special circumstances involving the dangerous children who bring weapons, drugs, or commit serious bodily injury at school. Let's move over to page 32, Section 504 and ADA tips. Have Section 504 procedures in place and train school personnel on them, and I would add, please. 504 is, like I said, up and coming for some reason. I'm not really sure why, but we're seeing an overabundance of requests for 504 services, 504 evaluations, all kinds of things. There is some confusion, too, that a 504 plan is better than an IEP. I've actually had several of those cases as well. Understand, number 49, that a student can be found disabled under 504, but may not necessarily need a 504 plan. It's a two-pronged process. First of all, the team determines whether the student has a disability and then moves into whether the child needs a 504 plan in order to have his or her educational needs met as adequately as those of non-disabled children. Remember also that the special rules of discipline for all intents and purposes apply for children who are disabled under 504 plan or not. Number 51, avoid exclusion of otherwise qualified disabled students from extracurricular and non-academic activities. I'll point to you here on the bottom of page 33, a Dear Colleague letter that came from the Office for Civil Rights in 2014. It's very, very significant. Number 52, be aware that developing a health plan or a nursing care plan might not be sufficient. The Office for Civil Rights pretty much is demanding that we take a look at children whose needs might be met by a health plan, but have we made sure that they have been addressed for whether they have a disability? So OCR is kind of expecting that of school districts, and it's become a little bit unmanageable from our very, very large districts, but just think about those children being protected from discrimination on the basis of disability. For instance, if the principal says no kids on health plans go on field trips, that could be discrimination solely on the basis of disability. Remember also, sort of in the same vein, number 53, that learning is not the only major life activity to look at under 504. in terms of determining disability. 54, I'll mention this one because it's very important. Recognize that the bullying of a disabled student could constitute a form of discrimination called disability harassment. This is a big, big issue. And even IEP teams, where the victim of bullying is an IEP team decision, basically, or an IEP team issue where the child is not receiving meaningful educational benefit because of it, the TK case requires it. Look at those two Dear Colleague letters as well. Recognize the potential at 55 for 504-based lawsuits alleging retaliation. We're all protected against retaliation, which is a form of discrimination, if we are advocating on behalf of a child with a disability. The Settlegood case actually is one of my favorite cases, and she settled good, all right. She got over $1 million in money damages. This was a former adaptive PE teacher in Portland City Schools who was let go because she was writing letters to the principal, the superintendent, and the special ed director, feeling like her kids with disabilities were getting the short end of the stick as it related to PE activities. This is a nationally known case in the area of retaliation. Last but not least, just to get us out of here, number 56, just be kind. In this world that's highly emotionally charged. Number 57, avoid the temptation to unleash your inner attorney. You all know who you are, right? I know the law. I've tabbed all of the rules, and I'm going to read them to everybody at the IEP meeting. That's just not helpful for anybody to do. Ditto with your inner judge. 59, remember to just breathe. Don't take, especially if you're in an adversarial situation, don't take things personally at all. We need to do a better job with this. I actually had a case one time where the special ed director called me and she said, I got a 50-page email from the parent last night and I have developed my lengthy response to it, but I decided I want you to read it before I send it. And I was like, oh, thank goodness. So I read it and I called her back. I said, I have one question for you. She said, what's that? And I said, do you feel better? She said, well, actually, just writing all that down, I do feel better. And I said, then delete it. We don't need to be getting into that. And last but not least, no good deed goes unpunished. Always do what's right for the child, even if the parent is demanding something other than what we believe is right. Courts will fault the school district for not continuing to provide a free, appropriate public education to a child with a disability. With that, maybe that was 62 minutes. Not too bad. With that, I need to let you go to your next workshop. Thank you so much for having me. Thank you for everything you do.